Hi guys, I'm coming to you this evening because I really just feel led in my spirit to share an experience that I had as a single woman. I've been celibate for 20 plus years, and when I say celibate, guys, I mean I don't have sex with people, places, or things. That includes myself. I don't do none of that. That's what celibacy is. It's abstaining from any type of sexual actions at all. Period. None. And for me, I have at times been the point of ridicule. Of people in my family have made comments, snide comments actually, and they've said things like, oh, you know, I'm gonna buy you some batteries for Christmas, and you know what that's for, because surely you're not celibate for real. And I just, I was disheartened by that comment. Actually, it was made by one of my siblings. There was another time that a comment was made that I must be a homosexual because I don't bring a man with me when I go to family functions. Another made by the same sibling. Another comment that was made is basically my standards are too high by one of my other siblings, which what that sibling actually said was, well, you want to marry Jesus. What you're looking for is only Jesus. And those things can hurt. And this has been years that this, you know, they've said these things. Well, that in my hearing, that is. In my hearing, that is. And I first want to say that those particular incidents, all they did was strengthen my commitment to walk with the Lord. They did bother me. I didn't like them. And I wish that people could just accept that there are people in this world that live for God and that are not having sex, that's not the norm, number one, according to the Bible. And then number two, that people could actually live without sex. Nevertheless, those comments were disturbing sometimes, but what I've most found out about that when they made those comments is that I had to be okay with whatever they thought, no matter what that was, that it does not affect me and affect how I choose to live, nor do I feel the need to prove to them, to argue with them, to persuade them, to try to make them understand why I live like I live. I live this lifestyle because that's what God has commanded me. Now that's where I'm living. That has not always been my story. I have been sexually immoral. You know, I have had sex outside of marriage and the whole nine. I've done a lot of stuff. Like Paul say, I'm the chiefest of sinners. Yes. Okay. So I'm not saying that, but I'm sharing this because, excuse me, I just feel led of God that somebody needs to hear this portion of my testimony. And it doesn't matter what people think. It really doesn't. It doesn't move me one way or the other because I understand why I'm doing what I'm doing. And I'm going to tell you something. A lot of times God leads us down a road, a certain road, because he's not just concerned with us, but he's concerned with leaving a legacy, something good for the generations to come. And I have come into the understanding and the knowledge that what I do with my life matters, not just to me, but for the generations to come, for my children, my grandchildren, my great grandchildren, should the Lord tarry. So my life is more than just about me. And I decided a long time ago, guys, that sex is not worth me losing my destiny over. It is not worth it. I'm being very mindful about what I say on this video because I really can get, shall we say, brutally honest about that whole deal. You know, number one, since when is it that 2 seconds, if it lasts that long, is worth my destiny? It's not. It's not at all. And I have to say this as well, that I can't do this on my own. I asked God to give me the gift of celibacy, and he has been faithful. And I can tell you that my life has flourished since then. There's not the overwhelming temptation and desire to, you know, run out, be in a relationship, seek a relationship, except one with him. That's the only overwhelming desire I have. I've found that my life is more than just about pleasure. There's more to me than that, you know, and I won't go on the rant about not allowing somebody to use your body, because we all know that we're not supposed to do that. And if you don't, go look in Corinthians. It'll tell you all about it. Get your concordance, search sexual immorality, or matter of fact, get on the internet and search sexual immorality, and all of the scriptures pertaining to that will come up. And there are lots of them, let me say that. But I really just wanted to address how people might treat you or say things because of the things that I experience. And maybe you don't experience it, I don't know. But people a lot of times think because you're single that you're not complete. They think because you're single that you're missing out on something. No, I'm not missing out on nothing. I am single, but I'm satisfied. I am completely satisfied, and I'm sanctified. And that's the whole point, is I'm sanctified. I'm living my life as unto God. You know, there are things that I get from my relationship from God that I could never get from a man. There are some things that we need that no man can ever fulfill. So because of that, I think we have to just be confident in the fact that, hey, God say this is the way it's supposed to be, and that's the final word for me. That's enough for me, because he knows me. He made me. He designed me. He formed me in my mother's womb, his words say, and he knows what's best for us. He's not trying to give us rules and laws and all that kind of stuff to hurt us. He's telling us these things because he wants to save us from pain. How many times have we laid down with a man, and if you're a guy, laid down with a woman and got up regretting it? How many times we thought this was the one just to only have to sleep with another one? How many times has that happened? Then as women, we want to say, oh, I had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then we have women say, oh, I could count how many men, or 5 men on my one hand, how many men I slept with. I ain't slept with 25 men like so and so. Well, newsflash, that Bible say nobody. We're not supposed to do it, none, unless we married. So we can't even take pride in how many, how few, or how many we have, especially comparison to someone else. And that's a whole nother topic. Don't compare yourself to nobody. Don't do it. Because that's the one thing in your life that nobody can ever beat you at. And that's being you, honey. Nobody can ever, there won't be another Thyra better than me. There will never be another Thyra at all. I am the only Thyra like me that there is. Now, I'm not the only one named Thyra. Didn't say that, because I met one right here in Vermont. But that's something nobody can beat me at. And I'm so thankful that I've come into the knowledge of this truth. And I'm going to share this, and then I'm going to really sign off of here, because truthfully, I'm supposed to be asleep. Then I lost my train of thought. Of course I did. I think I lost my train of thought, but nevertheless, I just wanted to share this because I find it hard to believe that I'm the only one that has experienced this, that people say things about being single and girl, why, when you gonna get you a man? Girl, how long you been by yourself like it's a disease? I've been by myself long enough to know that it's okay to be by myself. It does not take anything from me. For me, it does not devalue me because I'm by myself. And actually, I'm not by myself. Daddy God is right here with me. And he got my back, y'all. Better than any man could. He could do things for me that no man can. And don't misunderstand me. I'm not opposed to relationships. I am not suggesting that people be single all their lives. I'm not suggesting that at all. I'm saying in the season we are in, we got to enjoy it because we've been set aside for the master's use in this season, because we do not have to talk or just have a discussion with anyone about if we fast, if we pray, if we want to stay up all night in intercession, or if we want to hang out with our friends. There are so many perks to being single. I'm just saying. So cook if you want to cook, girl. If you don't want to cook, don't cook. Make your bed if you want to. If you don't want to make it, don't do it. You know, it's just a lot of perks to being single, but being single sometimes gets a bad rap. But I just wanted to share this with you all. Because it happens, people don't understand. Because one of the reasons people don't understand is because the ways of this world say you gotta have a man. The ways of this world say you gotta be with somebody. You gotta, what's the saying? They say, you have to, drive the car before you buy. No, boo. My mama say that, told me years ago, why would a man buy the cow and get the milk for free? I'm worth more than that, guys. You're worth more than that. Way more than that. And that ain't what we're looking for, no way. That's the truth of the matter. What we were looking for is intimacy, not physical intimacy, but emotional intimacy. Being in a place where we can give and receive genuine love. That's for all of us. That's a basic human need. And we can get that from God. And reality is, until we are satisfied with Him alone, there is no man that can satisfy us. Because getting married, now I want to discuss, I said I was going to be quiet, but I changed my mind. You know, people always say, and my brother, I'm just going to say it straight up. My brother, he always tell me this. He's not making a snide remark, though. He really believes this. He said to me, he said, you know what? You need to get you a man. Because if you get you a man, then you won't have to call me to come move you. You get you a man, then you can have some money. You get you a man. Blah blah blah. No. That is not what a man is for. Let's get that straight. A man is to be a helpmeet, and love is not about me. Giving love, being with somebody else, is about being able to love them, and that's why a lot of relationships don't work, because we all, and I'm guilty. I've done the same thing. Please know that. I've done this. I've gone in a relationship and put my best foot forward and played this role that I was one way because I wanted to like me. And then when we got, I'm talking about my ex, we got married. Hello. Then the real me showed up on the scene. And vice versa. He did the same thing. And we was both disappointed because we thought we was marrying somebody else. I would love to tell y'all a funny story. Y'all y'all know I'm not the cook, okay? Let's just keep it real. Those of you that know me know that. So I really didn't know how to cook and really still kind of don't. And so when I was dating him, what I used to do is I used to just cook him breakfast morning, noon, and night. And I guess he thought, well, I guess she liked breakfast. And so when we got married, y'all, I was like, yeah, I don't know how to cook. And I don't know what to tell you. I don't know what to tell you. Now, I deceived him. I was wrong for that. I was wrong for that. Because he thought he was marrying somebody who knew how to cook. Now, the good thing about him is he did try to teach me, bless his heart. Not a good student when it comes to that. Because I don't really want to know how to cook. That's just, you know, some people, and that's another point. Some people say a woman's supposed to be domestic. I'm not that woman. I'm just going to be honest. I'm not that one. I'm not Susie Q, keep it clean, Hazel type. I'm talking about sparkling clean. Now, let me tell you this. My house used to be a wreck. It's not anymore. And I thank God for that. Because I didn't never clean it up at one time in my life. You know, and people find that a reason to ridicule. And that's cool. Because it's true. I did do that. You know, I don't do that anymore. I don't live like that anymore. But I did for a long time, even as a Christian. I just didn't want to. I didn't feel like it. I was, anyway, no matter. I could give no excuses, but I should have cleaned my house, period. But regardless, that's my weakness. Don't judge me. Don't judge me, because you got a weakness, too. We all do, guys. We all got weaknesses. And most of the people that judged me about that for years and even condemned me, I'm going to tell you the truth, and said that God was never going to give me no house because I didn't clean the one I had. Sorry to disappoint you. That ain't true either. That's man-made. That's man saying those things. That's not true, because nothing is too hard for God. And whatever we need to be done to get us where we need to go, He going to give it to us, because he promised to give us everything that we needed pertaining to godliness. And so, you know, we can't judge people according to our standards. If it ain't according to that Bible, we need to just sit down and be quiet. And I had to learn that. That was not an easy task for me, because of my calling and the way that God works with me. I just didn't understand other people. I was like, well, why would you do that? You know, why would you watch a cussing movie? Now, don't misunderstand me. I don't think watching cursing is good for a Christian. That's just straight up. I don't think it's good, because it gets in your spirit. That's just my opinion. I didn't say that was the Bible. Well, I guess I could take you to the scripture, but I won't. But nevertheless, I had to learn that there are some things that God won't allow me to do that I see other people do. And for me, it's about my calling, and it's about me obeying him, not me saying, God, why so-and-so do this, or why you let so-and-so. That's not my business. That's between God and so-and-so. So I used to do the same thing. So when I share about what people said, I'm only sharing as to its effects on me. I'm not condemning them or saying anything bad about them. I'm just saying that as human beings, a lot of times we put stuff on each other that is not of God. We judge people according to our standards, and that not according to the standard of the Bible. And we have to know when it's the Bible and when it's an opinion. We have to know the difference. And let people be free to live by their own convictions. That was very difficult for me as well, because no, y'all need to live by these convictions, mine, impressing my standards on other people. And I don't have that right, because number one, I don't know where people come from. Their standards might not be where I think they are, but they probably are a whole lot better than they was when God found them. And that's what this is about. This walk with Christ is about maturing, not perfection. And I'm going to share on perfection one day. But I really came on here just to talk about the remarks that people make. And I just want y'all to know, if you're experiencing it, you're not alone. I've experienced it and I've overcome it because I understand why I'm doing what I'm doing. And I understand that that's the standards of the world that try to make us believe we gotta have a man. You don't gotta have no man. You don't have to have no woman. Come on, you weren't born with now. Matter of fact, let's go back to the beginning, okay? Adam didn't have no mate in the beginning. Yes, God did, but his first season of life was singleness. Okay, later on, he did give Adam a helpmeet, but notice this too, there were no other humans on this earth when he was talking to Adam. We have other humans, and God didn't make him a wife to have sex. He made him a wife to have companionship. That's what he made him a wife for, not so he could have sex. And some people think that that's just really twisted. No, God, trust me, God is an all-wise God. So I just kind of wanted to share my heart tonight about the remarks, because it don't matter what they say, it matter what God say. And I'm gonna say this, thank you Holy Ghost, the only time it matter what they say is when we trying to please them. But when we trying to please God, it don't matter what they say. My aim and my goal, I've learned, has to be to please God alone. No man, no woman, no child, none of that. I've got to want to be pleasing to God alone. That saves me a lot of frustration, a lot of disappointed expectations. It just saves me a lot of trouble. You know, being just disappointed because I tried to make my mama proud of me. And I'm just saying, these are some of the things that I did. Or I tried to make whoever, my pastor proud of me, or whoever it is, or somebody on my job, trying to make them happy. That's a dead road. It's dead, not dead road, a dead end road, I'm telling you. Because people are fickle. Y'all know we change our mind all the time. Today you're the best thing in the world. Tomorrow you do the one little wrong move and that's a wrap. They don't even know why you're born at that point. You know, and we just have to understand that our goal in life is to please God alone. And we do that, he gonna say, well done, my good and faithful servant. I'd rather do that than to hear him say, depart from me, you evil worker of iniquity, for I never knew you. I'm not letting sex get them words said to me. I'm not letting trying to please people get them words said to me. I just don't want to hear. I want to hear, well done, good and faithful servant. And the only way to do that, guys, is to live a life that is pleasing unto God alone. Now, I'm going to say bye. And I will come back to y'all now. I mean, I will come back to y'all soon. You know, especially since I got my little wig done, because I don't be liking to talk on here. I talked on here one day, and my hair was tore, but I was like, oh my God. But there was a burning in my soul, and I knew I had to do it. I knew God was talking to me. But anyway, y'all ain't asked me all that. Anyway, I love y'all, and good night. And just be confident in whose you are. Because if you can't be confident in who you are, be confident in whose you are. You are a child of the Most High God.